Welcome to VR Roundtable, episode 26. My name is Gary, and I'm from Leicester in the UK. And joining me, as always, is Anthony from Sacramento in California, and Steve from Louisville in Kentucky. And before we get onto the show and I pass it over to these two guys, I just wanted to quickly mention that last week, some of you may have noticed we had some new titles, some new intros, and basically we've got all new branding now on the channel. And I just wanted to mention this because Steve's been working really hard on this over the past couple of weeks, well, longer than that, past month or two, really, to make all of these intros and things come out. So I just wanted to mention that quickly before we carry on with the show. And we just hope you really like all of these intros, and feel free to give us any feedback on all of this stuff. But anyway, let's head over to Steve. So now all these intros and the rebranding's out of the way. How are you feeling now? I guess you're relieved to get it all out of the way.
Absolutely. This was fun. I didn't know anything about rendering and After Effects and things like that. So it was a nice little learning experience for me. And, you know, I felt like I can do some things with videos now that I couldn't do before. So from that perspective, it was fun, but I'm also glad to get it out there. I think it looks pretty cool. And, you know, I hope everybody likes it.
Yeah, it looks really cool. Well, I mean, both Anthony and I are really pleased with it, the way it's turned out anyway. But yeah, Anthony, so this past week, what have you been up to? Have you got anything to tell us?
Well, I'll talk a little bit later about Horizon Zero Dawn. I know I mentioned that like a couple weeks ago that I was going to try it, and I finally got around to trying it. So it took a little while, but I did get my hands on that and check that out. So I'll talk about that a little bit later. And I'm seeing King Kong actually after this show's over with. I wish I saw it before the show. I could maybe make a comment about it, but I will be seeing it later today. So that'll be cool.
Yeah, let me know what you think about that, because I'm taking my son to see that in a week or two anyway. So, but what we're going to do with this show, we're going to go through some of the news stories that we didn't quite get to last week with the GDC. So there's a few there that we can go over this week. And then we're going to be getting on to what we've been playing, because I know we've all got a few titles that we want to talk about on that front as well. But let's get straight into it then. So the first news story we want to talk about is one that came out of GDC, and this was with Valve and SMI, a company where they specialize in eye tracking, and basically they're teaming up with Valve to bring eye tracking to OpenVR. And this, what they did is they actually integrated some of their own technology into a Vive headset, so you could get some kind of eye tracking within a Vive headset. Now, it wasn't really focused on sort of foveated rendering or anything like that, but it was being used to within gameplay to sort of show where you are looking at and get some feedback within the game on where you're looking. So this was pretty interesting and came out of GDC. And actually, the technology behind this SMI technology was actually the same technology that was behind this Google face, mixed reality face scanning technology that we saw a few weeks ago as well, where basically people within VR, they could be wearing a Vive headset and you could see the rest of their face, which is hidden by the headset. So it was all pretty interesting stuff, that was. And this is all sort of interlinked and tied in with this eye tracking technology as well. But let's go over to Anthony, because I'm sure you've seen this. There's not too much information out there on this at the moment, but what did you think about this eye tracking technology and where it will go?
Yeah, it sounds very interesting. The thing I was most surprised about is it kind of sounds like they can take your existing Vive headset and retrofit it to add this. It doesn't necessarily sound like we have to take our Vives and sell them and buy a new Vive or buy the LG or something like that to have this built in. I mean, to have it built in, of course, but it might be possible that we can ship our Vive headset somewhere, have the eye tracking installed, and then have it shipped back. Companies are obviously playing around with this. We saw it also with the Swedish company Tobii, T-O-B-I-I. They also showed off some stuff there. On the Vive subreddit, it was really popular for maybe a day or two. They had this little GIF of a cartoonish character where the eyes weren't moving, where it wasn't tracked, and it was like this is the present, and then this is the future, and then they show the eyes moving around. And a lot of people were commenting in this thread like, oh my God, this had me so moved. This is incredible. I can't believe it. And I was kind of like, really? It's a cartoon character and the eyes are moving around a little bit. It's like, yeah, this is going to solve all our problems. But not to be like that, but I don't know. I wasn't completely blown away with the Toby thing. But this is big. We do need this. You mentioned, of course, the Google thing where it shows your face, and we completely forgot to talk about this. I don't know how many weeks ago that happened when that was a news story, and I actually wanted to talk about it. I just completely forgot to talk about it. But I was going to ask you guys, because I'm sure you've seen the pictures of these people's faces with like the headset, like transparent eyes, and then the middle of their face. Did anybody else think those people looked really, really weird? Did you guys?
I mean, a little. Some of that's the tech, and some of that's, you know, the marketing, or I don't know if it's actual marketing, but people like to do the expressions and to draw attention to it. So I the thing is I'm not really sure what that benefit is, other than doing some type of mixed reality or some kind of online peer-to-peer thing, where if you're meeting face to face with another player remotely, you know, you can interact with them in a more natural sense. But outside of that, I don't really even know what the point of it was.
No, I'm not too sure what the point of that was either, but it did look, I mean, I'm with you, Anthony. I thought the people in that did look a little bit odd, to be honest. They didn't, and again, I don't know where it could be used. What kind of, I guess it is just for promotion and for mixed reality, just to promote these games and experiences so you can see the person's face and their reactions within VR. But yeah, it was a little bit strange.
I do think, though, eventually, if the cameras can work in such a way where it, I don't know how they're going to do it, but if they could somehow like have a 3D model of your head, basically, if you could somehow get a 3D model of your head, and then it has the cameras in there that's like tracking this part of your face, and then if it takes that 3D model of your head and kind of adds that information into it, and then when we're in multiplayer games, like imagine if you're in Rec Room and you're playing paintball, but instead of seeing like a little cartoon Bob that's bobbing around, you actually see real people's faces. But the pictures that we saw, again, it's kind of a weird goofiness to it, but I guess you got to accept the limitations. But eventually, I could imagine, I mean, imagine if you're playing in a multiplayer game with all of your with close friends of yours, and they peek around a corner and you see that's your buddy Todd, and you see his face peeking around the corner and it really looks like him. I mean, that is going to be incredible for the social interaction and stuff. I just don't know how long all that stuff is away from, you know, where we are now.
No. Just going back to the eye tracking technology then, Steve, I presume you saw that they're working on, I mean, there's a few different companies that are working on this eye tracking technology, and it seems to be the general way that things are going, at least in a certain area. What do you think, and what kind of applications can you see with this eye tracking technology?
Well, there's foveated rendering, which is probably the most direct advantage of it. And I don't think they were really using it in this particular case with SMI. But outside of that, I'm not sure what the big draw is, so I have to leave it up to the people developing the technology to show me why I need it. Now, I do remember reading in relation to this news, and I think it came out separately, that the eye tracking, and honestly, I can't remember if it's specifically this SMI, SMI related or not, but the eye tracking, I had always assumed it just was looking at the pupil or something to that extent, but I guess it's actually looking at reflected light from the cornea, and those that have had LASIK surgery or those that suffer from a condition that I have, it's called keratoconus, where my cornea is slightly, think like egg-shaped, not to that extreme, but just to a little bit of a point. And this may create problems for us. If the technology can't get around that, you know, I may not be able to ever have foveated rendering if this is the way it's going to work. So for me, that is something I'm going to start paying more attention to, because it's flat out, it's going to suck if they get this stuff dialed in really cool and then I can't take advantage of it and have to keep it disabled.
Steve, you're obsolete.
Yep.
Yeah, I did see that actually as well. The fact that somebody was mentioning, I don't know where I read it, I guess it was on Reddit or something like that, where they were talking about this this LASIK surgery can affect the eye tracking technology and how well it can work. So it's interesting, and yeah, we'll have to sort of pay close attention as to how that's going to come out. But the other thing, just with the applications of this technology, one thing that I was thinking about and that has been mentioned before is the fact that we have certain amount of, well, very little control over the depth with a sort of depth perception within, aside from the stereoscopic 3D, depth perception within 3D is not necessarily natural, because things closer to you are generally just as clear as they are further away. And with this with this eye tracking technology, what they're able to do, the developers are then able to blur things within, if you're not paying close attention to them, that are closer to you, so it presents a more natural way of looking. And this can actually lead on to our next story, because this is something that came out called this was just a video that was made available last week, and it's the Avegant light field AR headset. And I did see this mentioned, but Anthony, you forwarded this to us just to have a quick look. Why don't you tell us just quickly about this?
Yeah, I don't have any inside track on it or anything. It's somebody posted the video of this. I forget which day it was when this first hit, but it's another AR competitor that is in the same space with, of course, HoloLens and Meta and eventually Magic Leap and any of these other companies that are out there. But what was interesting, if you watch this video, it appears like they have a finished headset. I mean, their headset looks farther along than the Meta 2 one that actually already has a developer version that you can buy, I think, for around $1,500. HoloLens, the developer version, is $3,000. And Magic Leap, of course, we haven't seen anything from them yet. We've only seen like little rumors and snippets of stuff. But watching the video, it looks very interesting. But again, all of this is like, until we actually see this ourselves, like Steve has actually tried HoloLens. I haven't tried any of them. I don't think Gary's tried any of them either. Nice. So it's hard to really comment too much about it. I mean, if it's real, if it's legit, the thing about the Avegant is they're talking about different focal planes. And with their light field technology, multiple focal planes simultaneously. So it's kind of what you're talking about, Gary, where things need to be able to blur. And like if you're seeing a table that's 5 feet away and you have a certain focus on that table, then the artificial object that they put on that table needs to have a similar focus at that distance for you to buy into the illusion. Otherwise, one of them's blurry, one of them's not. And there's some problems that come along with that. Now, supposedly they have these multiple focal planes. And if that's true, some people in comments to this reveal is like, oh snap, these guys have come along and they're stealing Magic Leap's thunder, because Magic Leap has always talked about light field, you know, their light field processing engine and all of that. And HoloLens is using a little bit of a different technology where they're kind of refracting the light off of little grooves in the glass. It's a little bit different. But I don't know. I mean, I don't have much to say on it, because until we actually see these things ourselves, it's really hard to say. Anybody can make a nice looking video with CGI and all that stuff, and until we really get some real world tangible results, it's really hard to comment on it too much.
Yeah. In that video, Anthony, there was a portion towards the end that said, little words came up at the bottom, was captioned and said, captured through the lens of an actual device or something to that effect. So that does demonstrate that they have it actually working and were able to capture it. It's not created in CG after the fact, though. And we can link this video in the show description. The technology itself, though, I think it really only, it's a problem that I think exists more within AR than VR. In fact, I'm not sure we even have the problem within VR, at least not to the degree that I've noticed, but with a mixed or an augmented reality, when you're seeing your hand and then the object in your hand, those focal links and the focus effectively does need to line up, or else it probably will scramble your brain a little bit. You're talking about the entire lifetime of getting used to the way your eyes operate, and then suddenly it being different. So I think they've demonstrated a need, and I think they've demonstrated that they've gotten it working. And prior to you showing this to us, I had never heard of it, had never seen it. So I think it's good that they said, you know what, we're really gonna lie in the dark, lie in the weeds, and then, you know, be reasonably far along, or so it appears, and then we're gonna come out and start making some noise. So I look forward to following it a lot more.
Yeah, I'd be interested. This video, it was really interesting to see this video. Just a few other details on this as well. It's not a standalone headset, the same as a HoloLens, for example. It's still tethered to a PC. So this is a limitation at the moment with it. Also, I mean, they were saying, Avegant was saying that they were expecting a consumer product to be released within the next 12 to 18 months. Presumably that will be tethered to the PC as well. It won't be a standalone headset. And also, in order for it to track room scale, it uses a similar system to the Vive in the Lighthouse. It's using external sensors. I don't know if they're laser-based sensors or just sort of infrared sensors similar to Oculus, but they do use external sensors to replicate the room scale experience. So I thought it looked really good. It's difficult to say, again, like Anthony says, it's difficult to get a good idea of how actual good the experience is when anybody can put these kinds of videos together. But Steve, you're right, it does say like this was captured through the lens and it looked pretty good. With the headset, what I noticed is the way it seemed to be, it's the lenses within the headset itself, it sort of seemed to be like it would be quite a narrow field of view, similar to what we're seeing on the HoloLens. But until you're using it, I guess you don't know that. They obviously didn't mention any of the field of view or anything like that in this video either.
You know, one other quick little thing about the headsets is all these videos that we see, the big thing about AR, like a lot of people are like, no, I'm betting on AR. And I'm betting on AR because you see your actual world and other people that are inside your room, they can actually look and see your face and see your eyes. So it's not like you're sealed off in some other universe. But if you looked at this video closely, it's like this headset wraps around you and then you have the two things that are in there, which is really doing the magic. And on this particular company, in comparison to HoloLens, it almost seems like your eyes are blocked. So if somebody was standing like 7 feet over there and they're looking at you, they're not going to see your eyeballs whatsoever. And then you have this big bulbous thing going around your head and it's darkened. They obviously need to darken it for it to really work the way you expect. So everybody makes these arguments for AR like, nah, VR isn't going to work. You're sealed off. People can't see you. Well, this stuff isn't quite ready for prime time either. You're not really wide open where everybody can see you. So we've seen that these headsets are bulky. They take up, they're kind of obnoxious looking a little bit. So I don't know that AR is instantly going to be this like, oh yeah, the mass market's going to jump on AR because now you can see your face.
I just want to add, I hate that argument, by the way. Like, isn't that kind of the point of VR, is to be completely closed off and somewhere else? Like, this idea that I need to see my couch is just kind of like, I could see the advantage of it in some things. Yeah, it'd be fun to sit on a couch or dive behind the couch and shoot aliens. But at some point, every game you play can't take place in your living room or whatever room. So being blanked out, so to speak, and somewhere else, to me, is the point and is kind of the biggest draw. Like in Resident Evil 7, like, I don't want to see my couch. I want to see their crusty, dirty couch that the bakers have, you know? So it's like, I just, I don't get that argument.
No, I don't. I get what you're saying as well, because the ideal, I suppose, would be something where you can have a AR headset for certain things, but then it can sort of completely blank out in order to give a virtual reality experience. And I personally think that virtual reality is a better medium for gaming than AR. I mean, like you say, Steve, you don't want to be constantly playing games within the same setting in your house. It's just, I mean, you've got characters that could move through your living room, but there's only so much you can do with that, really. So I think, you've got a good point there. Okay, let's move on to the next one. And this was just a small news story that came up. Well, I guess it's small for a lot of people, but it can mean quite a lot for some others. And this was the AMD will soon support asynchronous reprojection. So these GPUs, you know, we've had asynchronous reprojection on the Vive for a while with NVIDIA graphics cards, and now all the AMD graphics cards are going to be getting this as well. I don't know when it's coming out or if it's now been made available. I'm not too sure, but it's something that is a big deal to a lot of people, and I think it's made my overall experience within VR pretty quite a lot better, really. Because asynchronous reprojection can give you very, very smooth turning, even if your PC can't necessarily keep up with the game or experience that you're playing, you can still get, within rotational head movement, a very, very smooth experience. And that can deal with a lot of the problems within VR. You know, if you're using a standing game or even a cockpit-based game, you're not necessarily going to be moving within room scale too much, where you would still experience the juddering. So this asynchronous reprojection can eliminate juddering with rotational head movement, and it's a big thing. And people with AMD-based GPUs have been waiting for this for a while. So I don't know if either of you have got anything to mention on this at all.
No, I don't. I think you covered it well enough. I mean, it's proven that having this kind of benefit, especially in a space where we don't have unlimited power to run these games and such, that every little bit helps. And really, you know, we have Oculus, in my opinion, to thank, or maybe ZeniMax to thank. So AMD getting compatibility, okay, one step forward.
Yeah, it's a good thing, and hopefully eventually as well, because this is sort of the equivalent to asynchronous time warp on the Oculus. So hopefully at some point as well, all us Vive owners will get the equivalent for asynchronous space warp, which will give us smoother experiences within room scale as well. Okay, I'm going to pass it over to Anthony now. He's got a few stories revolving around PlayStation VR.
Yeah, there's a couple little stories, nothing really major. I did see this news story pop up about a game called Korix, which is, it's kind of a real-time strategy game, but it also has some like tower defense type stuff with it. But the key thing about this game is it's supposed to be the very first PlayStation VR game to natively run at 120 frames per second. And the cool thing about this is that Ben Lang from Road to VR, I believe he actually was able to try a demo of this, and he mentioned that it's just very, the sense of reality was heightened because it just has a more natural, it just feels a little bit better. There's something that you can't really pin it down or explain it very well, but we've also heard that some people in the VR world have suggested that we could possibly benefit all the way up to 240 frames simultaneously. And we remember back when Gabe mentioned that there would be headsets that would be 200 frames or higher. And so to see native 120 frames, I'm actually very much looking forward to this, because I just have a feeling, you know how when you're in VR and you're in there for like a half an hour or so, you come out, you're kind of drained a little bit. And I feel like if we were operating at like really high frame rates, maybe there's less eye fatigue, and maybe we come out of it and we don't have kind of that drained feeling. So definitely looking forward to that. Also recently, Sony invited a lot of journalists, gaming journalists, to come check out five different games that they're showing off at one of their PlayStation Experiences things for PSVR. They showed off Farpoint, Starblood Arena, fantastic contraption, static, and the persistence. Now, we knew about all of these games except for the persistence. The persistence is coming from a company called Fire Sprite, and it's a first-person survival horror game. It has a lot of stealth mechanics and melee combat. And what I noticed in this is in the trailer, the graphics, some of it reminded me a little bit of like Arctica 1. It looked pretty good graphically. Of course, with all of these trailers, I mean, you can go back to like Battlezone for PlayStation VR. I've seen trailers for Battlezone that make that thing look like it's running on a 1080, you know, SLI 1080 Ti's, two of them. I mean, it makes it look incredible in some of the trailers. And then when you actually get Battlezone, it's like, it doesn't really look like that. So I'm not sure if the persistence is going to look that good. But hey, we definitely need some PlayStation VR games, more of them, to be announced. And so at least there is this as well. And then the last little blurb I have regarding PlayStation VR is Farpoint. We all know that Farpoint is arriving on May 16th, but if you are an Amazon Prime member, you can now pre-order Farpoint. The pre-order is up. You can pre-order it. And for Amazon Prime members, Amazon does have this deal where you get 20% off your games if you pre-order it in advance. And for Farpoint, because it's $80 if you get it with a gun, the game itself is $50, and then you're paying like another $30 for the gun. But if you buy it separately, the gun's a lot more. And if you're an Amazon Prime member with that discount, it's almost like you're getting the aim gun thrown in for free. So that's pretty cool. I'll kick it over to Steve. Steve, do you have any comments to any of these three PlayStation VR stories? Anything jump out at you?
Nothing really jumped out that was, you know, amazing or radical. I like the new software announcements, and I wasn't aware of the persistence. So that kind of tackles something we've talked about in the past. What's next after Farpoint? Regarding Farpoint itself and the being able to pre-order it now for $80 or with a discount, I think that's a fair price. You know, I was worried about it being a $60 title plus like a $50 accessory. I was thinking maybe this thing was going to come for $100. The fact that I can get it for $64, I am an Amazon Prime member, have been for many years, and I think I would end up divorced if I thought about canceling it. So I'm probably going to get it that way. And it's sort of a no-brainer. And the only thing, though, is I kind of accept that it's going to be a Farpoint controller for a long time. I know some games have mentioned compatibility, and I think, ironically, Brookhaven. I don't know how in the hell that's going to work. But I think most of that's probably going to be hacked in. You know, it's just going to be, they're getting some compatibility just because Sony wants there to be some compatibility. I think it may be a while before there's another game that really leverages it. And honestly, I hope that's successful and gives notice to some people making devices for the HTC Vive or for the Steam platform, because I think having that thumbstick on it is going to help with locomotion. You know, we talk so much about onward style locomotion, onward, and the trackpad's not the greatest. We're seeing the result of that also with Robo Recall, and having a thumbstick in some way, I think, is really critical to these open environment shooters. So that's where I stand.
One other thing I'll mention about the aim controller is, If they bring out this controller, from what I heard, it feels cheap. It doesn't seem like it's very impressive. But when you actually get into the game and you're actually playing Farpoint, all of that kind of fades away. And because in the game of Farpoint, you're playing with basically like a space rifle, like kind of like a Halo pulse rifle type thing where you would hold it with two hands, I actually could potentially see a really nice future for this controller, because what is the most popular genre of game right now? It's first-person shooters. And in most of the first-person shooter games, you're holding a machine gun, you're holding a rifle, or you're holding some type of space rifle or what have you. And for those games, this would work absolutely perfect. You have the thumbstick for your locomotion, and you've got two hands, and you got that vibration and all of that. And it supposedly it tracks really well. So I think that could be really cool. But of course, at the same time, we have seen in the past, I mean, everybody, you think about the Sega Genesis. The Sega Genesis had the Menacer, and then Super Nintendo had Super Scope. And those guns came out, and I think there was like maybe two games that worked with them, and that was it. And when those things were announced, I mean, this is way back in the 90s, but when those things were announced, there was all this talk that, oh yeah, there's going to be all these games that use it, and then nothing ever happened. But in this case, I think if you keep making first-person shooters, my only real problem with the gun is Brookhaven, if you're just holding a handgun, How do you hold that thing if it's just a handgun? Because you're not really using, you know, I'm not sure how just a handgun would work. But as long as in the game you're holding an assault rifle or a sniper rifle or something like that, I think it would work quite well.
And that's why I mentioned Brookhaven specifically, because, I never finished Brookhaven. I should go back and do that for one. I kind of got through the sewer and it got really hard and I started playing other things. But up to that point with Brookhaven, I pretty much only had a one-handed pistol of some sort. I don't remember there were one or two pistols. And I don't, for the exact reason you mentioned, Anthony, like it, trying to hold, maybe you can kind of like Arnold Schwarzenegger the thing and hold it with one hand and it feel okay. I don't know. But I just, when I heard about Brookhaven, I was like, that seems like it's just kind of a half-assed, baked in, let's make it compatible because we can. So I really need to see how that's going to shake out.
I kind of wish that this aim controller, I kind of wish it like snapped. You know, it snapped and then now it's a handgun and it snaps back and now it's a rifle. That seemed like it would be hard to design it like that. But if they could do it like that, it seems like it would make a lot more sense. But oh well.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that actually. The fact that if they could somehow make this into something a little bit more like that, where you have the option of sort of one-handed, or you can hold it like a rifle, that'd be great. But like you say, it might be a little bit too much on the design front. And I don't think that this is a bad price. You know, you're getting Farpoint and the aim controller for that price. It's pretty good, really, I think. And from what we hear, Farpoint is sort of quite a long experience, quite an in-depth experience as well. So I just hope you get a little bit of quite a few story elements, because just going back to like Arizona Sunshine, that was more or less just a wave shooter where you moved around from location to location with a few very, very small puzzles within there. But even that narrative within that game just made it so much better. Just the very loose narrative that it had connecting all these dots together made it so much better. And I hope Farpoint can take that and maybe even go a little bit further with it as well. Before we move on to the next one, we'll stick with PlayStation VR, because there was this announcement really for these Mantis headphones. Now, these are some headphones that actually clip on. They're made by a third party, Bionic. They're a company that have manufactured these, and they clip onto the sides of PlayStation VR, and they work in a similar way to the Oculus Rift headset, really, where you have the headphones attached and they can lock down or you can raise them up as well. And they look pretty good, and a lot of people want integrated headphones on their VR HMDs. So these were something that I saw. Did any of you guys see these, and do you think it's a good idea for PlayStation VR?
I did, and I'm very, very, very interested in checking these out. And the good news is, you know, with it being a PlayStation VR product, it stands a good chance, I think, of ending up in a Best Buy or a GameStop, which means I can go and buy them, take them home, try them, and if I don't like it, I can just easily return them. I have a tendency when I buy things off of Amazon, even though you can return, it's kind of a hassle, and there's a lot of stuff that I intend to return that never ends up going back. Because when it comes to something like this, you could end up totally loving it or hating it, and you really don't know until you try it for yourself. But I think it's a good idea, and I absolutely love the Halo design of the PSVR headset. You know, maybe it's part of that stems from being a Vive owner, and the straps are basically abysmal. But the downside with the Halo is that it can make getting over-the-ear headphones difficult to put on. Like, I can't get my Sony Golds on, so I went out and picked up these Turtle Beach headphones that I'm wearing right now that are designed specifically for VR, and they're notched in such a way that I can get them around the halo, but it's still not perfect. Like, I have to position them. I can just actually do it. I have to kind of slide them forward a little bit, and I don't love that. So if these Mantis headphones can resolve that, I'm highly interested.
Yep. Do you have any problems with these with headphones on the PlayStation VR, Anthony?
Well, I use these headphones, and like Steve was saying, that there is the halo, and it kind of pushes it out a little bit. So what I have to do is I have to kind of pull this like longer, you know, and then kind of lower my thing a little bit. But it works for the most part. One of the biggest issues with PlayStation VR, though, is the little dongle that they have that you actually plug your headphones in. I have a super, super short cord that I can use with these Sennheisers. I can take this off and I can use this. I can use a really short cord for it, and then I can plug it into that little dongle. But what inevitably happens regardless, even though I'm using this like really short cord, is my left arm, it's like I'll get tangled in it. And I'm like, you know, because I have the headset on, I'm playing, I'm trying to play the game. And then it's like, ah, damn it, you know, and I'm always like fidgeting with this. If there are somehow, if actually on the headset itself, it had a little plug up there, and then you could snap this thing on and you could run the wire to a little plug up there where there's no wires that are going to be interfering with any of your torso, that would be huge. This is not going to do that. They're going to have to run a wire to that dongle. There's no way around it. So I don't know that I'm going to be that hyped into this unless people are just raving about it.
Yeah. The last news... Sorry.
Well, on that, I thought it did something in the images I saw. It looks like it kind of it cupped out in a direction where you could attach it, and maybe it comes with some sort of like little wire clip or something similar to what you'll get a lot of times with headphones. In some of the stuff I see, it looks like that they've thought of that to a degree. I think it'll be a minor solution, but it looks like you can route it where it kind of stays with your main tethered cable for the HMD as a whole.
Headphones on PlayStation VR, correct me if I'm wrong, but to use headphones like I'm wearing here, these the PlayStation 2.0, you don't get the 3D sound. Is that correct with these? You have to actually have them wired into the little connector on.
Yes, it's the same. Yeah, it's the same as the Vive. You have to have it plugged into the headset's audio port in order to get the 3D audio, because it just comes that way. If you use the wireless function, just similar if you were to put a Bluetooth or a wireless transmitter in your PC and try to play a Vive game like that, you'll get the audio. It works. I've done it. But you don't have the true processed 3D audio.
No. Okay. Yeah, I'd be interested to see these, because I think they're a good idea overall to have something like this. And just going back from a personal point of view as well, the deluxe audio headphone head strap that's coming out for the Vive, I'm interested to see that. I'd love to give that a try before I commit to purchasing that, because I don't find that there's a big problem, really. I actually use the earbuds with the Vive. I've got them sort of wired in so I can just place them in once I've got the headset on. It's not a big problem for me, but I'd rather they weren't there like that. I would much rather have some integrated headphones. The more I think about it, the more I'm moving over to that direction, really. Okay, the last news story I've got to this week is on this. This was just a small one, actually, and I don't know a lot about it, but this was the Tactical Haptics, who have created sort of compatible Vive controllers. Basically, what they're doing, they're using they're using the Vive trackers is one option, and these are connected onto a controller which they've designed, and it comes with thumbsticks, so you don't have to use the touchpad anymore. And it works like a Vive controller, but it's using the Vive tracker in order to sort of emulate the tracking for the Vive controllers. And you have a few options, actually. You can use the Vive tracker, connect a Vive tracker to this, or you can use one of their own proprietary tracked sort of form factors, really. It's basically a Vive tracker. It's using the same thing, but in a different form factor that they've designed. And you can also use these with the Oculus Touch. They have a clip to attach an Oculus Touch to. So this is just something that was interesting to me because it's showing how we can have these different kinds of controllers, and they can work just as well. They can track just as well as the Vive controllers. And it was especially interesting to me because I've mentioned quite a few times that I'm not a big fan of the touchpad on the Vive controller. So anything where we can get some kind of, or at least I can try a thumbstick, then that's always going to be interesting to me. Steve, how about you? Did you see these?
Yep. And I love the idea. I really hate the touchpad on the Vive controllers. If I could buy an Oculus Touch and somehow make it work with my Vive, I would run out and do it right now. The touchpad, we have the iPhones and smartphones and tablets, and everything was becoming touch this, touch that. And I think that's kind of, I don't know if Valve just kind of wanted to push it. You know, I know they have their Steam controller that also has a touch surface, but it seems like not everything needs to be touch. Like, it's just trendy. And I think it's just, I don't think it makes for very good gaming at all. And I don't like playing games on a tablet either for this kind of the same reason. Like, you know, a touch-based game like Angry Birds or something I can do, but any game that tries to simulate traditional kind of controls like a D-pad with a touch element is just it never works for me. It's something, it's either me or everyone agrees. It's kind of one of the two things. But this controller, and I love the idea, and it's about execution. I know they can track it by having the puck on the end of it. But again, it kind of goes back to something I mentioned many episodes ago, is they're going to somehow have to get that model of the controller into Steam VR somehow, so that when you are actually holding that controller, you have that one-to-one representation. It does no good. It's kind of like when we're playing Revive games or Oculus games via Revive. Sometimes we see the Oculus Touch controllers, the representation of them, like when you start up Robo Recall, but you're holding your Vive wand, so it's a little... it's a little disconnected. And I could see that happening with like this tactical haptic controller. But if they are able to get the model in and able to the system to somehow know that's what you're using, either you tell it, I guess, in your Steam VR configuration, something like that, and then that's what you see, then I think it's a great idea, and I would be very interested in trying one.
Anthony?
Yeah, I've seen pictures of this thing, but does this thing provide, because when I've seen pictures of it, it looks like they have a prototype of the old HTC Vive controller before it ever came out, like the prototypes of Steam. And then it has like this weird blue thing that's like strapped to it. And I thought the idea behind this, now I might be getting this wrong, I didn't read a ton of stories on this, but I thought it provided like some type of resistance. Like you do certain things and you feel like pulling, or you feel like... almost like you're touching something, and it has like, does it do any of that?
Not as far as I know. It does have a slightly, with the grip buttons, instead of having the grip buttons, it does like have a squeeze pad type thing around the grip itself. But other than that, I don't believe it does anything like that.
Oh, okay. See, I was thinking that maybe it did like some type of weird resistance type stuff. And I thought, now that's cool. But if you have to buy a Vive tracker, and then you pop this thing onto the Vive tracker, each Vive tracker is $100. So two of them, that's $200. And then whatever they charge on top of it to attach it to it, you're getting pretty pricey there at a certain point. And then it's a third party peripheral. How many games are actually going to support it? I think a lot of Steve's frustration in regards to the trackpad might be because of like recency bias with playing Robo Recall through Revive, because, oh my God, we'll talk about this a little bit later, but it is difficult to do that. But if I'm playing like Windlands, or if I'm playing Doom 3 BFG and I'm just using my touchpad like it's a D-pad, I don't have much of a problem. It's a little weird. You do have to kind of adjust to just pushing it with your thumb in certain spots, but I don't know that it's like absolutely horribly broken because it doesn't have a touchpad.
I don't have issues with using the touchpad as a D-pad. I have issues using the touchpad as an analog response. And that's, to me, it's where it really breaks down. And when I played Doom 3 BFG, it never felt exactly right. Like, I really, really firmly believe that a thumbstick is just needed for locomotion, if you're going to try to do it that way. Other than that, you walk and teleport, which I think that's why most of the Vive games seem to have used that. And it wasn't until Onward that we had this kind of analog representation on the touchpad. And it's great that they did that, but it's still not quite right, at least for me. I honestly can't stand it. So much so that when I tried the locomotion mod in Robo Recall, I practically dislike it as much as I do their teleport. So I'm kind of, but again, I do accept that it may just be my own personal taste, but I've never gotten used to it.
Just going back to what you were saying before, Anthony, about these controllers, it does look like, actually, just reading a little bit more about this, that originally they were going for something where it could recreate some kind of friction against objects as well. It had some kind of advanced haptics within these controllers, at least the early versions of it, reactive grip, so it could simulate the feeling of friction on objects and certain things like this. So maybe that's what you saw originally.
Yeah, that probably was it.
Okay, that's pretty much all I've got this week for news stories. Is there anything else that either of you want to add?
Nope, I don't have any news. It was a slow week, like you said.
Yeah, we had GDC last week, so that's where pretty much all the news went into last week's show. But okay, let's get on to what we've been playing, and who wants to kick this off first this week?
I'll go ahead and start it off, just because I got Horizon. I talked about it a couple episodes ago that we were kind of having this discussion, you know, flat gaming and VR gaming. And I said I wanted to try to get my hands on Horizon and check it out. And so finally this week, I did get a chance to try Horizon. And basically, I can cover this from two different angles. I can cover it from just Horizon Zero Dawn as a game, or I can cover it more from like the VR flat gaming thing. But first, I want to just take a couple of minutes just to talk about Horizon Zero Dawn, the game. Before I was ever interested in VR, I saw Horizon Zero Dawn. I believe it was first revealed at E3 a couple of years ago. And when I saw it, I was like, oh my God, this game is drop dead gorgeous. It looks amazing. You got these robot dinosaurs, the world that they've created in this game, incredibly lush. But I was kind of worried about it as well, because it's like Guerrilla Games, the makers of Killzone. You know, Killzone 2 was pretty good. Killzone 1 on the PS2 was kind of good, but I've never been like a huge Killzone guy. And I'm like, am I really going to trust these guys to make like some really good game? Well, fast forward a couple of years to where we are now, and I still listen to a ton of gaming podcasts, most of which are not VR focused in any way, shape, or form. And everybody had been ranting and raving about Horizon Zero Dawn. It's like maybe game of the year material and all this type of stuff. And I did buy that PlayStation 4 Pro back in November, mostly to boost the performance of PlayStation VR. But in the back of my mind, I was like, oh yeah, Horizon Zero Dawn. This is that 4K game that like really takes advantage of PS4 Pro. We all know that Guerrilla Games, they know how to make a good looking game. I mean, they know how to pour it on with visual effects and all kinds of nice little tricks. And so I did get a chance to play this, and the thing that really jumps out to me about Horizon Zero Dawn is the story is pretty incredible. Anybody that has a PlayStation 4, even if you're really into VR and you never play regular games on your PlayStation 4 anymore, I say rent this game, give it a try, because if you like good stories, like watching a movie or like a Netflix show, the first couple of hours of Horizon Zero Dawn, it's kind of like you're going through a lot of story and a little bit of tutorial. And so you'll control your character for a little while, but then it will go to like an Uncharted cinema kind of sequence with a lot of storytelling. And then you'll control your character a little more and then more story. And that's kind of the way it is for the first couple of hours before you actually get set free into the world to kind of do anything. And in this first couple of hours, the story was incredible. I mean, I give straight credit to Guerrilla Games and to Sony. The story is absolutely magnificent. It's just minor spoilers for anybody. This is like just the first couple of hours of Horizon Zero Dawn. I mean, I'm not going to get into like any serious story spoilers or anything, but the game starts off and it's basically this little baby girl and this older middle-aged guy that's like taking care of this little baby girl. And then it kind of fast forwards a little bit, and the baby is now like a little 3 or 4 year old girl. And then it fast forwards again, and she's like maybe an 11 year old, 12 year old girl. And you're kind of going through this story where this girl is, something happened with her mom, you know, We don't know what it is. And she's an outcast and there's all these tribes and they're not allowed to talk to this girl. They can't even utter a word to her. And she doesn't understand because she's like playing around and there's other little kids, tribe kids that are there. None of them will talk to her. None of them will interact with her. And she's like super depressed and she doesn't understand what's wrong with this world. Why will nobody talk to me? She doesn't know what happened to her mom. But anyway, the story is just incredible, and I highly recommend it. And if you compare it to the VR thing, the thing that jumped out to me was like, man, when is the last time I've experienced a really good story? Because I haven't played any flat games in so long. I've only been playing this VR stuff. And in VR, the stories are lacking. I mean, what's the best story in VR? I guess you'd have to go to Gallery Episode 1, Call of the Starseed.
Resident Evil 7.
What?
Resident Evil.
Oh, Resident Evil 7. Yeah, that's right. Resident Evil 7. I forget about that. Yeah, Resident Evil 7, pretty good, but it's not, I mean, yeah, there is a story, but you're kind of in the game and moving along. It doesn't do a lot of cinema type stuff, but bottom line is this Horizon Zero Dawn, it's an incredible story, and the gameplay is incredible. The graphics are incredible. The battling these robotic dinosaurs is really awesome. The AI of them is really good. But what I did notice is I eventually got to a point where like, okay, I'm done. And this is going back to Redbox. That was cool. I checked it out for 3 hours, but now I'm done. And what happened was, I got to a certain section of the game where you're battling this large dinosaur, a much more ferocious dinosaur, and you have to set up these traps and you have to pre-plan and you have to craft your arrows and your medicinal herbs, and you have to get every, like, if you're going to go battle a robot in this game, you don't just go in and battle the robot. You got to make sure that you're prepared to battle the robot. Do you have all your arrows? Do you have all this and all of that? And I got to a certain point where it's like, okay, I kept dying, and it was a really cool adventure going up against this beast of a robot, and in 4K, oh my God, it is absolutely drop dead gorgeous. There's like little flickers of lights and stuff that when you see it in 4K, it's kind of like the J.J. Abrams. You know how J.J. Abrams in his movies, he always makes these little like lens flare things that are like really shiny lights that will flicker in a certain way. And it really has this in spades in Horizon Zero Dawn, and all that looked really good. But I got to this point in the game where it's like, oh yeah, this is a regular game. Okay, I got to battle this dinosaur, and now I'm kind of hit a stuck point. And it's like, you know what? This is flat gaming, and it's cool. It's cool, but no, I'm going back to VR. So I took the little disc out and put it in its Redbox case and drove back to the store and put it away. And so, but it's cool. If you do have a PS4, check out Horizon Zero Dawn. It's worth checking it out for a couple of hours just for the story of it.
Do you think that's a game, because it's obviously like a third person adventure type game, really, do you think that's a game that could eventually one day sort of translate into VR, even though it's third person? We've got a few third person games in VR anyway. Do you think that kind of game would translate well?
We've seen third-person games in VR. We've seen Lucky's Tale. We've seen Robots Rescue in Playroom VR. You can make a third-person game. I haven't played Chronos or Edge of Nowhere or some of the games that are in Oculus, but you can take a third person character and you put that character there, and then you're external from that character and you're kind of hovering behind that character. Now the camera is going to be an issue. Is the camera going to be able to flow nice and smooth and not be too unsettling for people? But yeah, they could put you into that world of Horizon Zero Dawn. The problem is flat gaming and VR gaming are going in two completely different directions, because flat gaming is like, okay, 4K, let's make everything look drop dead gorgeous. Everything's beautiful and stuff. But one other thing I noticed playing this in 4K, to notice 4K, you got to be right up on your TV. I mean, you got to sit hella close to notice the actual difference that it brings to the table. But if you took Horizon Zero Dawn, you put it in the VR, then all this beautiful, lush graphics, it could surround you and envelop you, which is amazing. I'm imagine turning around, you see dinosaurs over there, you see the tall grass that's swaying in the wind and stuff. But the problem is the resolution. It's going to be a long time. I mean, it might be like 6 years before we can play something like Horizon Zero Dawn, but where the world is completely enveloping us and surrounding us.
Yeah. Okay. If you got anything else that you wanted to mention, Anthony, what you've been playing this week?
Well, can I talk about Robo Recall for a quick little minute? Because like, you guys played Robo Recall last time. I did not get a chance to play it until just after our show ended last week. And I've been playing Robo Recall almost every single day. And oh my God, this game is amazing. I'm totally in love with this game. But it's almost like a love-hate relationship, though, because I love the game, but the controls, oh my God, I want to strangle to death. I want to shake somebody, whoever. I mean, I know it was designed for Oculus Rift, and there are all these locomotion mods that you can try, and I've tried a bunch of the different mods, but all of the mods, I haven't found a mod yet that seems to be designed to be like, okay, yeah, you have a Vive. Okay, so let's make a mod that kind of translates this game to the Vive controller, because it's not translated very well. Steve was saying that he would rush out and buy a touch controller if somehow there was a touch controller that had the little lighthouse sensors on it and you could just use it, so like you could really have a deluxe Revive experience. That would be incredible, because then you'd actually be able to control the damn game. But through Revive, oh, I'm struggling to an unbelievable degree to try to play the game. And the thing is, I'm still doing it because the game is so, I don't even know how to explain it, but this game, man, you can grab these robots, you can smash them together. I don't even want to use guns. I do not want to use guns in this game. All I want to do is grab this robot, throw him over there, grab that spider robot, slam him into that guy, grab two of them and smack them together. You know, take your gun and throw it at the guy. The gun goes flying. You grab it again. You blow him up. It's kind of like super hot. The music reminds me of Sega CD. It reminds me of the Sega Saturn. The look of the game, when the game first starts up, it looks like Daytona USA on the Saturn or like Sega Rally on the Saturn. It has a very mid-90s Sega arcade feel to it, like the announcer and some of the little graphical things that it does. The dumb things the robots say, you know, they start talking about robot heaven, I can see it. And it's just hilarious, man. I just have such a good time, but I'm struggling with the controls to the 12th degree. There has to be somebody out there that can create a mod that recognizes the fact that I'm a Vive player and this mod is designed for Vive players. Because I've tried the Locomotion 5, the guy that has done these Locomotion mods that are really popular, the last one is Locomotion 5, and you can kind of onward style movement a little bit, and you can hit a button and you jump way up high, but then you accidentally hit somewhere else and then your view goes like this, and it's like, oh no, this should not happen. This does not feel good. You do not want to go like this at all, but it allows you to do that, but it is just so wrong. I just wish I could play the game the way it's meant to be played and like room scale and just grab the robots and slam them everywhere. This, you know what this game is? Do you guys remember, I don't know, maybe in the 80s when they would have those balls that people would squeeze for their stress, That's what Robo Recall is. This is your stress ball. You know, you a hard day of work, you come home, you play Robo Recall, and you thrash the hell out of these robots. You juggle them with your bullets. You smash them everywhere.
Until the locomotion makes you more stressed. It's like a stress ball that won't squeeze.
Yeah, it's frustrating. It is. The locomotion is frustrating. And what you were saying, Anthony, about not wanting to use guns, you want to just go up and grab these robots and smash them in together. I definitely get that. But part of the frustration comes from the fact, in order to do that, you have to teleport close to the robots. And by using the teleport, it just brings in these frustrations. Hopefully, I mean, they have said they are going to bring out some kind of a patch, which will hopefully give some kind of teleport options. I don't mind the teleport. I just don't like the implementation of the teleport in this particular game.
Yeah, because you see a robot right there. You're like, okay, I'm going to teleport. I'm going to grab him and slam him into this other robot. But what happens is you teleport over to him. You think the robot's going to be right here. And then you turn around. Oh, now he's over there because it put me in the wrong.
So when you see that arrow, when you're teleporting and you see that arrow,
I know.
Think that's the direction you're facing after you teleport. Like, I'm going to be looking that direction. But isn't it maybe like, that's where the front of your room is?
That's right, yeah. Yeah, it's designed to be where your front facing is. So you could still be facing this direction. It's completely off.
Yeah, I wish Epic would just create a checkbox, and I assume it would apply to those with three or more sensors on the Rift, that says, keep the teleport the same, just make that go away. Like, and make the when you're looking behind you, make that message go away. And then if that's a quote unquote mod, maybe they could have those as options, hard options in the game, and then you can continue your story and keep track of your scores and things like that. Because when you try these mods, it disables all that, which is frustrating. Have either of you guys gotten to the first boss, Odin?
No, I haven't. I'm on level 3 in the city. Okay. I think I'm on level 3.
Yeah, it gets, and I'm not going to spoil anything. There's not that much narrative to spoil anyway, but I'll just say that it gets, like, when you think you've experienced it all and you're like, okay, this is polished, like, this is awesome, it gets even more awesome. Like, they have a few tricks up their sleeve, so you guys definitely got to keep playing. So I'll go ahead and go since I'm talking. I've played several titles this week. I played a little more Robo Recall, as I just mentioned, but I played two little short experiences on the PlayStation VR. The first one, Oh My Genesis. It's been out for a while. It's like a $2.99 little real-time strategy game. And I have a Let's Play of it either up or coming. Sorry, I can't remember. And really, all it is you kind of in the same vein of Tethered or Robots Rescue. You are looking down on this world. And what's different, though, is that it's a planet, and you can reach out with the Move controllers, and you can grab the planet and spin it. So instead of you moving over the planet, you kind of bring the surface of the planet where you want to look to you. And it's kind of a unique approach. And the gameplay itself is just it's just a little puzzle slash strategy game. You're moving the little creatures. They call them owlies, and they're cutesy little kid type things. And you're moving them to a resource, like cutting down trees, and they build huts and things like that. And one of the funny things they do, though, is shortly after they become adults, I guess, they'll get a little heart icon. And if another one gets a little heart icon, they'll come together and mate, and they'll go in the hut, and the hut will start shaking. And then a couple seconds later, the two come back out, and there's a little baby following them. So I thought that was kind of interesting, because here's this really kid-like, cutesy game, like, you know, my 6-year-old could play it and like it, but then they're going in there and I could see him saying, Dad, what are they doing when they go in the hut? So parents beware if you're going to let your kid play that game. It's not vulgar in any way, and it's real cutesy, but it kind of draws attention to it. So I thought that was interesting. And again, the game's only $2.99 for the base game, and you get a sort of a tutorial planet, and then you get a second planet that's like a full level, and it maybe takes you 10, 15 minutes. It's not too terribly long. But then for $2.99, there is at least one more planet, maybe two more planets that you can buy. So for $3, it's well worth it. It's probably one of the better $3 experiences I've had, in VR. I can't really say anything bad about it for that. And then one of the other things I played was a trial for a series that is really popular in gaming. Not popular in the Call of Duty kind of mainstream American sense, but popular in the Japanese sense. And that is Cyber Danganronpa. I don't know how to say it. Dangan, there's an N at the end right before the in there somewhere. But they've created, it's just a sort of a demo or of a trial of what the game would be like in VR. And it's just a portion of their last game, I believe. And it's available for free, so anybody can check this out. I believe it's for free. I don't know if it's just a PlayStation Plus thing. But in this game, you really don't know what the hell's happening. You're standing there and you're in a trial, a sort of a courtroom type trial, but you got this demonic teddy bear for sorts. He's kind of like Two-Face from Batman. He has a good side and a bad side, and he's kind of split down the middle, and you're trying to figure out who committed a crime. But the way you do it is they make comments, and the comments words jump out from them. The words are actually on the, you know, in the environment, and you have to snuff out which is the lie and basically shoot it. Like it's just really bizarre, and it's really difficult. You don't know what the hell you're doing, but it's free, and I thought it was worth the 10 minutes. It's, you know, I could see maybe if you had the full title and you could get really enveloped in that world, how it may be a fun experience. The small taste from the trial, though, makes it hard to really get going, because it's over by the time you figure out what you're doing. So I played those two, and then the last thing I played was I finally finished Resident Evil 7. I had wanted to finish it before I went on vacation, and that didn't happen. And I thought I maybe only had an hour or two. So I started playing it at around midnight and ended up having like 3.5 more hours. It was almost 4 o'clock by the time I went to bed. And I just now, having played it and completed it, it just kind of reaffirms that it is my favorite title in VR. It's just so good and developed and feels real. And, you know, Anthony mentioned earlier about narrative and how, you know, he's like, you're just in this place. I think they wrap up the narrative. It has a very cinematic feel at the end, and it gets very Resident Evil. I won't really spoil it because I don't want to do it for people, but there were moments. I kind of felt a moment with one of the key main characters in the game. And I just, you know, at the end, I was just, all right, I'm going to go buy the DLC. I haven't done it yet, but I'm going to. I'm going to kind of give myself a little bit of separation and play some other things. But Resident Evil 7 is an experience, and I just absolutely adore it. And having completed it, it's a 14-hour game, $60, the probably some of the most well-developed 14 hours of VR I've played.
Excellent. Yeah, that's one I definitely want to try as soon as I get the opportunity. Yeah, that's what up there. Okay, well, I'll go next. I've got three titles I want to talk about, but the first one I'll talk about because I want to make sure that I get this one in, and that's Mission ISS, the International Space Station. And this is a free title on Oculus Home, and this is basically you're placed within the International Space Station, a very detailed and seemingly accurate representation of it as well within VR, and you can go around and explore it and do some of these small missions as well within this. But it's free and it's awesome. I absolutely love this. I think it's great. Anybody who owns a Vive or an Oculus Rift, you have to give this a try, even if you've got only sort of a mild interest in space or the space technology or anything like this. When you first open this experience up, you're presented as if you're floating above the Earth, and then you'll turn around and you'll see the International Space Station sort of floating towards you, and it'll come past you, and it's huge, and it's just rendered so well. I think this is part of the thing about this is everything is rendered with so much detail, and it's an Oculus Studios title. And one thing I've noticed about Oculus Studios is that they have a certain look about them. I remember playing First Contact when the Touch first came out, and we could get some of these free downloads from the Oculus Home. And First Contact is this one where you're in like a camper van, and you're there with like this futuristic robot, and it's got a certain look about it. The environment is very, very detailed. And this experience, Mission ISS, has a very similar look. Everything about this seems like they've spent a lot of time in really knuckling down and getting the nitty-gritty of all the details of the International Space Station absolutely right. I think it looks fantastic within VR, one of the best looking experiences, and it makes it even more better when you know that this is sort of a semi-accurate, presumably pretty accurate representation of what the International Space Station looks like inside. But anyway, you can go around it, and it starts off, you're floating through, and it'll show you how to locomote through this space station. You can move using thrusters on the touchpad or the Oculus Touch thumbsticks. But you can also, in a similar way we've seen in some other titles, sort of grab onto things and drag yourself through this space station. And that works really well. That's probably my favorite method of moving through this place. One thing I will say that's a little bit odd, but I can see why they've done it, is that within this, you don't really feel like you have a body. You're a floating head and you have two hands. And the reason I say, obviously it's like that in a lot of experiences, but the reason I say that in particular with this one is because it doesn't sort of, you don't feel like you find yourself colliding where your body should be. You don't collide with the walls or anything like that. So you really do feel like you're a floating head that's going through the space station. And the reason I say I can understand why they've done that is I think it'd be quite frustrating if you're constantly getting caught on these things, on these walls and these openings within this. So I think that's why they've done that. And it works okay, but that it does sort of separate you slightly from the experience and maybe breaks immersion. But
Gary, I was just going to say, because I tried this experience as well, and I agree pretty much with everything you're saying, but like what you're saying there, the thing that I found weird with it is you're going through these hallways, and you're grabbing on the poles, and you're pushing yourself through, and it feels really good, but then sometimes you go down really low, and it's like your head is like a soccer ball that's on the ground, and it's like your neck and your body would be like through the space station way outside. And that is weird, but yeah, like you said, if they gave you some type of body, you'd be constantly getting stuck on stuff. So
yeah, that was one thing I noticed as well. When that's where it hits you the most, I think, where you really sort of you accidentally, because you're floating through this space station, sometimes you can't really guide yourself with that much accuracy, and sometimes you do find yourself on the floor, and it's like your body would really actually be within the floor. So again, I don't see it as a major problem with this, but it's just something to mention. And what you can do is you can go through a few little missions, sort of very basic missions. Although, Anthony, I'll ask you actually, how far did you play through this? Did you play to the part where you have to use the external arm on the space station to dock with a supply at all?
No, when you first load it up, there's like three different options. And I went into, I think, the far right option the first time I did it. But I didn't really know what I was doing. Really, I just kind of wanted to screw around in there. They have like seat cushions and stuff, and you can kind of smack them, and you know, they're floating in zero gravity and stuff like that. And for me, what I liked about it was I would go to these little nooks with inside the space station where there's windows and you could see the Earth. And I would like climb down there and like be looking through the windows and like, oh, this is really cool. But I do kind of wish for the days when we do have the resolution, you know, to really make, and like if the Earth itself, if it was like slowly moving, and if you saw like clouds, you know, moving over the Earth and stuff like that, I wonder 7 years, 8 years from now, can we do an experience like this? And will we actually feel like 90% of what an astronaut feels like? Because you always hear this, that astronauts will talk about when you see the Earth externally, it's a weird emotion. You feel weird because it's like, that's the planet I came from. That's where I live. And now I'm external to this planet. And it's almost like this religious experience that astronauts will talk about. And I wonder if we'll be able to get like 90% of that once the resolution is just drop dead gorgeous.
Yeah, well, just on that point, actually, because within this experience as well, what you can do is you can point to various things, and it'll either play, it'll sort of have like a picture and a short description of what's going on, or it'll play a video with actual astronauts that are in the space station as well. So, and they actually talk about some of what you've just mentioned, Anthony, in some of those, like this woman will talk about where she's looking down, like within any free time that she gets, because it's quite an enclosed space, she'll go down to this area. I think it's called the cup or something. I can't remember exactly what it's called, but it's basically like a glass bottom boat almost, where you can just look down and view the Earth. And she says a lot of the astronauts will spend a lot of time in there, just when they've got a bit of time off, just looking at the Earth. And that's really what it is. And like you say, maybe when the resolution really gets to that point where you can just let yourself go within this experience. And I'll say, you know, if you do let yourself go and just really imagine yourself within this place, you can, it can have quite a big impact with you. But one thing with this as well, the missions, because I started off with the tutorial and it then leads you on into some of these missions. I was really struggling with this one where you have to guide an arm, an external arm, and dock with a supply drop. It took me quite a while to get through that because I was trying to dock with the wrong part in all of this. So I wasn't doing too well. But anyway, what it is within that, you're looking at three monitors. You have to go to a specific part in the space station and then look at three monitors, which show you cameras of the external arm that you're guiding. So you're sitting within VR and you're looking at these flat screen monitors. Now, then you're using joysticks to guide this arm, looking through the camera onto these monitors. The point I want to mention about this is John Carmack was talking about this a couple of years ago before VR was really ready for consumers, before it came out. And he was saying that memories formed within VR can be almost as real as memories formed within real life. You get to the point where it's difficult when you think back of being within VR in certain experiences, that you don't necessarily make that jump that you are in VR in that experience. You just consider it as part of a memory that you already have. And this is something I didn't really understand what he was talking about. And for the first time when playing this game, actually after playing this game, I was thinking back to this section because I was really struggling with this. I was really struggling to guide this arm to dock properly. And in my memory of this, actually going through this, I was looking at three screens in wherever I was. It didn't matter where I was looking at three screens. And I remembered just looking at three monitors in front of me. Obviously, now when you think about it, I was in a space station, a virtual representation of a space station, looking at these three monitors within it. And it just hit me really hard, this did, how it can really... when you ignore all of these external parts and you just think of where you are at that moment, it really shows the power that VR can have in the future, I think. And when we get to the point where resolution is no longer a problem, I really do think that this is part of what John Carmack was talking about these memories. And it really hit me hard in this particular experience more than anything else. But yeah, that's Mission ISS anyway. And I'd say definitely download this one.
How long is it?
Well, I've not played through the entire thing yet. It's not particularly long, but it's free. And what you can do at the end, the part that Anthony went into first, you can actually do a free roam and just go around and just explore this International Space Station and do... There's certain little things that you can learn, and like I say, there's videos that play. But I've still not played through the whole thing yet because I was struggling for so long on this one little part of the mission. There's not a great deal of interaction, I wouldn't say, within this. It's really more you're just going through and exploring this space station.
I think there is something to looking at a monitor or a display device within VR, because I felt the same thing. I haven't played this, and I'm not trying to take it back to Resident Evil 7, but I am. There are scenes where you're looking at a CRT TV in the game, and I guess because of the lower resolution, the CRT TV is very, very realistic, and you're sitting there, and it feels, I don't know if I had the same experience you have, but I do remember feeling like, man, this is really real, because one of the characters was talking to me through this TV, and and the TV felt really there. And it just, like you say, it's a memory. And that's the way I feel about, you know, that game in particular, like that house, like it just, it, I can see myself a year from now remembering what it felt like to be there, even though I wasn't there. And I think that's really cool. And that's really exciting for virtual reality as a whole.
Yeah, I think part of it with these screens, like monitors, looking at monitors within VR, it's sort of like your attention is so focused on those, like in this particular experience, I was so focused on these three screens, looking at what was going on there. I was ignoring everything else that was being rendered in VR around me. My memory of that situation is I've got these three screens in front of me, and that was where my focus lie. And it only hits home when you think back to that and you realize you're also in a fully rendered 3D representation of the space station. It just hits you then when you're thinking back to it. But it was an interesting experience, and yeah, I highly recommend that one. I'll just very quickly touch on a couple of other games that I've played. ROM Extraction was one that was on sale last week. I think it still is, actually, until the 14th, March 14th. So you can get 75% off on this title on Steam. So it's usually £14.99 over here, and I picked it up for £3.74. So absolutely bargain, really. A lot of people were complaining about this, how short it is. For £15, I'd have to agree, it is very, very short for that price. For £3.74, which I picked it up for, I think it is a bargain, and it is a really enjoyable game. It's a wave shooter, as you can expect, a lot of these games are, but this one, it's got a few interesting sort of mechanics where you can, in your right hand, you hold a gun as usual, but then in your left hand, you can spawn an orb. And what you're able to do is throw this orb at the enemies, and it will kill the enemies much quicker than your gun will. You can sort of put 10, 12 bullets into an enemy before they'll die. So it can take quite a long time to kill them just with your gun. But what you're able to do, you can throw this orb at the enemies, and if it hits an enemy, it'll blow up and it'll kill them. But what you can also do, the interesting parts of this game is where you can spawn different types of orbs, and they all have different sort of criteria and different things that they can do within the game. So some can bounce around, some can sticky onto the enemies. But what I find the most enjoyable is just with the standard orb, you can throw it in the air. Then by using the touchpad, you can slow down time, as we do in a lot of these wave shooters. You know, you've got bullet time. But what you're then able to do is, while this orb is floating in the air just above the enemy, you can shoot the orb and it'll explode and take out a few different enemies. And you can be really tactical about the way you do this, because you only have so much time that you're able to slow down. So you have to be quite tactical in how you're doing it. But it really encourages you to use these orbs in the best possible way, because, as I say, if you're just using the gun, it can take a long time to kill these enemies, and it's not really an enjoyable way to play the game, just shooting the enemies with the gun. Using the orbs and using them in different ways is really where the game comes into its own. So, yeah, I'd recommend that people pick that up for the sale price. I don't know if I'd recommend it for the full price, although the developers are saying that there's going to be a lot more maps coming in the future as well. Finally, I'll just talk very quickly about PowersVR. This is one which is very early access. There's not a lot to it at the moment, but it's a superhero game, so you can fly around, do various different things. It's got quite a good range of superpowers that you can try in this. Yeah, it's just basically an open city at the moment, done in a very, very comic book style. So everything sort of has quite a thick outline around it, sort of done in a comic book way. And there's not a lot to do. There's a few enemies just wandering around the city, and you can just experiment with the superpowers that are there at the moment. So not too much to say. It's £5.69, so it's not the cheapest game in the world, but, you know, it's a budget game. And you know, if they were to say that this is the finished game, this is what it's going to be, I wouldn't recommend it for that price. But the developer is very, very active on Steam, and he's saying he's actually quit his job, this guy who made this, to work on this full time. So I expect a lot more content will be coming, and he's promised a lot more details on this game soon. So yeah, probably I'd say probably hold off on that one for now and see what comes in the future. Okay, has anybody else got anything else they want to?
Yeah, I completely forgot one. So I played this very short demo. It's not available via Steam, but it is called a Walk-O-Motion, and it's developed by somebody named Nimzo Ni. I believe it's Japanese. I may be mispronouncing this person's name. But it's VR Super Mario Brothers. But it's not by Nintendo, but it looks pretty cool. The Goombas are a little bit, I think it's level 1-1. The Goombas look kind of weird, and everything is not perfectly Mario, but the whole point of the demonstration is, this walk-o-motion idea that this person has developed. And basically he's not using motion controls, at least not the Vive controllers, just you have to do this with a gamepad, but you tell the demo that, okay, I'm going to walk, and you press up on the thumbstick, but you won't move while you're pressing up on a thumbstick. That's just the way you're kind of telling the game, I want to start walking now. But then you start walking, you start taking steps with your actual body, and you'll start moving in the game. And it must be monitoring, you know, I guess, kind of the head, your headset wobble, kind of the natural wobble you take when you're walking. And then when you jump, you press a button to jump, but then you actually have to physically jump. So in this game, this demo, you know, you can break bricks and collect coins and jump into pipes and jump and smash on Goombas. And it feels it's kind of like what Mario would be if it was available in VR, at least a translation of the 2D Marios. And this is a free demo, and we can put a link to it in the show description, so anybody can check it out. Now, it's actually developed for the Rift, so I went ahead and injected it with Revive. I don't know if you actually need to do that, but it's worth checking out. It's unique. It's not the greatest game, because it's not really a game. It's really just meant for a demonstration. But you have Mario music. I don't know how this person was able to just put Mario's music right in there, and maybe it's just not popular enough that Nintendo hasn't given them some sort of back away legal notice of any kind. But you know, the Mario music's playing, and it's vibrant, and it's colorful, and it looks good, and it's got all the Mario stuff, even though it's not perfectly designed. And it's worth checking out. You know, I was surprised when I come across it, and I forgot how I actually found it. I think I must have seen it on YouTube in some way, and I downloaded it and tried it. So forgot to mention it.
Cool. Okay, so I guess we can call that a show if everyone's finished and ready to move on. Yeah,
I did play, I forgot to mention, I did play Dirt VR, Dirt Rally VR.
And oh yeah, I played that too. I'll save it for next time though.
I rented it from Gamefly, right? And I completely forgot that you can't just put the game in and play it. You got to pay for the VR add-on, basically. So I paid $13 to do it, because I figure, what the hell, I got it now, I might as well pay the $13. And it's pretty cool. I like it, but I honestly don't know what everybody on the PSVR subreddit was going so crazy for. I kind of like Drive Club more, but I don't know.
I think if you have a wheel, and I think if you're really into racing, like it's more of a sim. I think it's more in the vein of Gran Turismo or Forza in that sense, except of course the dirt rally flavor. And I think it's more in that sense that you have to drive right, and that it's punishing. It will punish you if you make mistakes. Whereas Drive Club is more arcadey. And I bought it for the same reason you mentioned. I was like, well, I'll just get it on Gamefly. But it's like, hold on, I got to buy it. So when it was on sale for like $35, I went ahead and bought it, because I knew if I tried to rent it, I was still going to be in it for $13, $14, $15 anyway to get the add-on. So I went ahead and bought the title. But I do think that me personally, my own take, that I would probably enjoy Drive Club more. And it's on my list if Gamefly ever decides to send it to me. And I look forward to the Gran Turismo product coming out. And I have to get my racing wheel upstairs to my office where my Vive is and try some of the titles there. I do have a Project Cars in my library, and I think at some point there was a portion of the game, must have been free or something. I've never even played it, but it's in my library. I don't know how it got there. It's the only way I can think of how it got there. So I want to check that game out. So, but maybe we can talk about Drive more in depth some point in the future.
Yeah, which game looks better within PlayStation VR? Does Dirt Rally look better than Drive Club? Because I know that was often a criticism of Drive Club.
I think Dirt Rally looks better.
You think so?
Yeah, I think it's clear. I'm not sure all the assets are higher quality and more realistic in nature, but the resolution, I feel like it's running at a sharper resolution. Things are clearer, but I don't think things are necessarily as graphically complex.
It's pretty chunky. It's pretty pixelated. I don't see a huge difference. One thing about Dirt Rally VR, though, is like before you start the race, you hold down the options button to center your view. And you'll have like you're in this rally car, right? You got a guy sitting right next to you and he's fully rendered and he's holding like a instructions or whatever. And he's like talking to you as you're racing. But what I noticed is my head would be like right by where the ceiling of the car is. And then I would start driving and about like 1 minute into the race, my head is clipping through the ceiling and I'm seeing like this, like whiteness up here, and it's super distracting. And I'm like, damn, why is it doing that? And then I try to get a little bit lower because it's like, it's breaking the immersion. It's screwing it up for me. And that kind of bothered me. But on the positive note, the one positive thing I will say about Dirt Rally VR is you're going up these mountains and around these mountains and you're way up on like cliffs. And if your car goes off the cliff, it darkens and so like your car is like tumbling and rolling and stuff. But what it does is it darkens your view and you just see a little tiny portion of your view. But the thing that I'll say about it is when you're up on those mountain cliffs, if you're like me, because where I live here in Sacramento, California, Lake Tahoe is not too far away from where I am. It's about a two hour and 20 minute drive from Sacramento. And you're going up some treacherous, like around these cliffs and stuff. And like whenever I drive up there, it just makes me nervous. Like I don't like being on that outside edge where you're by the railing and like you go over that edge, you are done because it's like thousands of feet down or whatever, you're dead. And when I was in Dirt Rally VR, and sometimes I would be on these mountain edges and I would get close to where like my wheel is almost going off that edge, and I would almost feel this sense of like, you know, like this weird feeling, you know. And so that's pretty powerful. But that was the only thing about it that I could really say that really jumped out at me, like, wow, this is awesome.
Yeah. Okay, well, we'll leave it there then this week. So that was VR Roundtable episode 26. You can email us at vrroundtable@gmail.com and feel free, you know, leave comments below this, like the video, and feel free to share it wherever you want to share it. That's always appreciated. But yeah, if you guys, is there anything else I've missed off there?
I just say, like you said at the very beginning of this show, Steve did take a lot of time and effort to make this trailer. And I'm sure that we have a lot of audio listeners that maybe have never been to YouTube, never checked any of our YouTube stuff out. And I understand that, you know, I listen to a ton of podcasts where they have like a YouTube thing and I've never checked out some of their stuff. But if you do get a chance, I'd say go ahead and check it out just because it is cool. He spent a lot of time on it. And it looks really cool. I think it's almost like too good for us. It's putting pressure on us to create better content that follows that intro. But I was just really proud of what Steve was able to achieve from that. And so if you've never, ever checked out our YouTube channel, maybe check it out if you get a chance.
Yeah. Thanks for that, Steve. You've really put the pressure on us now. We've got to do some extra good content now. But it is really, really good.
In that vein, I do want to say one thing. Now, I did put this stuff together, and like you guys say, I worked pretty hard on it, and I appreciate the positive comments, but I do also want to give credit where credit is due. I did not, everything that you see in these videos was not developed from scratch. I was able to purchase assets and some royalty-free assets, so I didn't create everything from scratch, although I think I could figure it out. That is an enormous amount of time, so I think maybe in one of our show notes, I'll go ahead and link everything that I either purchased or got outside of my own creation from scratch, but I don't want to take credit for, you know, I don't want to give the impression, I should say, that I developed everything from the raw pixel. You know, some of this stuff was borrowed and pieced together and
you shouldn't have told him, Steve. Just say you spent like 200 man hours on this thing.
Well, you know, I'm not sure I'm not sure 200 man hours would be enough to do all this stuff from scratch. So I just, I want to be fully transparent. I don't want anybody thinking I'm some master motion effects guy, you know, maybe one day, but you know, not now.
No, it's done a really good job either way, but yeah, so check that out. Check out the YouTube channel, and yeah, like I say, just leave comments and like any videos that you like, really. But thanks for watching this episode. That's, like I say, that's been VR Roundtable episode 26, and we'll see you next time.
See you guys
late.